My grandfather died when he was 86 years old. He was alive at the turn of the century. And part of his success was being able to use tools to turn the soil, to tend the crops, to take care of his farm. That was a team of horses or a team of mules. As farming got older, it was your tractor. We gave way to the horses and we gave in to the machine. And the machine helped the farmer be more productive and get more done. Everybody's got their favorite car or their favorite tool. The tractor was an extension of the farmer himself, and there is a relationship between the person and the tools of his trade.
I feel like tractor pulling's got away from where it started. Yeah, it started out to be just a good old down home country. You take your tractor, I take my tractor, we'll weigh them both same, we'll pull them. Stop. Everything stop. Don't change nothing. Leave the tires. But then all of a sudden, this guy takes his, he soups up the motor, he puts a little camshaft in it, he sharpens his tires, and he beats his neighbor 50 feet, or he's mad. He goes changes his cam, he goes changes his turbocharger, he goes back, sharpens his tires, he comes back, beats him 10 feet. So yeah, it's got away from it, you know, but there again, it's tractor pulling now. Back when it started, it was just having fun.
To a person that does not know nothing about tractor pulling, the farm tractor, a few of them was built with gasoline back years ago. There's no farm tractors today hardly built at all with gasoline and spark plugs, it's all diesel. Every farm vehicle is turbocharged diesel because they get so much more fuel economy. But in the early days, there was a few tractors with LP and with gasoline. And somehow or another, they've been able to change and go along and get into alcohol, which is a racing fuel, see.
How it all started, I grew up on a dairy farm, and this is documented in my mom's baby book, you know. I don't know how much of a historical novel that is, but it is documented that the third word I said was tractor.
It's like once I crawl on that track and that tractor's running, all of a sudden everything's okay. I don't understand it with me, but it's always been like that. Whenever it comes to the time to do it, it's just like I become somebody else clear off here. You know, I become part of that tractor. It's not me no more. I don't even think about me. There's nothing me about it. It's just we are there, you know, and it's a feel. And if a man don't get that, he's never going to be any good at tractor pulling.
What goes on at a tractor pull is that the trucks and the tractors actually pull what is known as a weight transfer machine or a sled. There's a box on that big machine there. In the box, you can see them loading the weight into that box. As the vehicles go down the track, the box pushes down upon the sled, and that increases the drag and thus slows the vehicles down, and it's whoever pulls the vehicle the farthest.
there's just some people that are better at things than other people. And some people do their homework. And Leroy Mason's got some good equipment, and he's got some good people backing him. You know, he knows where to get the good stuff, and Leroy knows how to make it work.
Everywhere Leroy Mason unloads, there's not anybody that don't fear that tractor, what he could do with that thing.
He beats him with skill and horsepower, not with just plain horsepower. He just, if you could give him a little less against them guys than what they have, and I think he'd still beat them.
My name is Leroy Mason. I'm from Warsaw, Kentucky. First tractor I went to was with my dad in 68, just a little old county fair pull. I told Dad, this is too cool. Can I ride with you? Nope. Can't do it. They don't allow no riders, boy.
Leroy watched, he watched me for a long time. That little fella wore out several pairs of tennis shoes walking the side of the track.
We've been pulling a long time. We've had a 560 International Super Stock tractor. We ran it for several years, ran it all through the 70s and 80s. When the technology caught up, we went with this tractor. We built two tractors, complete chassis, rolling chassis, ready to go, add power. And we never did finish them. Somebody would come in the shop and they'd say, "Well, boy, that's nice, I want to buy that. How much you want for it?" Well, I'd scratch my head and Dad'd say, we'd set a price on it, boom, it'd be like, buy it.
I told Leroy, I said, "That's it, we ain't making no more." I said, "If we're gonna do this, we'll just go buy one and use it for that purpose."
And he says, "We're gonna find a tractor, we're gonna buy it, and that's gonna be it." He said, "We're going to the track, we're gonna pull again." I said, "Okay." Well, we bought the tractor from the Corse brothers 4 years ago. There was a couple pullers up at, one time they caught me up there in Wisconsin.
We was pulling in Toma, Wisconsin, at a Grand National Puller. I get up there by these tire cutters, which is the Corse boys. While I'm over there, there's these two Kentucky boys standing around, and they're interested in this International alcohol tractor that Corse got for sale.
Kenny McKillop, "Where are you guys from?" You know, Ken is. "Oh, we're just from Kentucky." And I think at the time he just thought we was a couple of cow pies from down south, you know.
And these two boys was over there, and I looked at them and I thought, well, there's gonna be another Southern tractor, you know, and I never even gave it a thought.
"Well, that's a good strong tractor there, and you know, I don't know what you guys are gonna do with that down there, but it's a good one."
And I've seen this tractor run against it, you know, it's just never impressed me, you know, as far as being anything that I was thought about, you know.
So we bought it and started running this circuit here with it. And now we run into Ken all the time. Ken's a good guy. Got a lot of respect for Ken McKellar.
And as time got by, that experience from that day, that tractor's come to haunt me now.
Larry's just a super nice guy. I don't really, he's been real helpful to me on acquiring events. He's been a real good supporter of this organization, but he's so close to being a Leroy himself in regards to, he's got the capabilities of dominating that class. For 10, 12 years, I've watched, and I've seen different combinations work. Larry Phillips is close.
When I was trying to buy a pulling tractor, I got a good friend of mine, Jerry Sipes, that's a puller. He's an alcohol man. And he said, "Well, we'll buy it together." But he wants a red tractor, because he's a red man. I said, "Okay, that's fine. I wanted a pulling tractor, and he was a red man, so I needed a little bit of coaching, so we bought a red tractor." If Linda knows we're going tractor pulling, she's a pack the day ahead of time, and her bags are in the truck before I ever get loaded. She enjoys it better than I do.
Some people get out here and get high on drugs and stuff, but I get high on tractor pulling.
I got a 12-year-old boy that launched that was previous, and then we got Michaela and Brandon. Michaela's 4 and Brandon's 2 this year, and they're both tractor pull babies. So I guess that tells you a little bit about what happens on the roads to tractor pulling.
This is something he drawed when he was in the fourth grade. I took all of my kids, and we all got tickets to go to the tractor pull at the fairgrounds.
Freedom Hall.
At Freedom Hall. And I took him that first time, and then he's been interested in it ever since. So I guess I got him started into it.
I do have a lot of on my mind a lot of times, and tractor pulling kind of takes all that away for a little while. I enjoy it.
First time I went tractor pulling?
Yeah. I stole my dad's tractor out of the barn as a little baby Sea Alice because the neighbors were down with a boat in a field playing with tractors. And I went down there and we all got to hook on this old deadweight skid, you know, that had chains on each end of it. And we'd put a tractor on top of it. And each one of us would take turns of dragging it around the field. That's 47 years ago. I used to sit out there with my brothers when I was a little kid on the tractors, you know, open fender tractors, and sat there and sing that old song on top of Old Smokey. And my nickname's always been Smoker, you know. Well, I ended up with a diesel tractor, which everybody calls a smoker, so I said, that's it, put her on there. I've been able to accept losing. You know, when you start out with this thing, and I won 5 or 6 Grand National pulls the first year with it. I won the Indy Super Pull, you know, and I mean, it just kept on going like this, you know. And I've got up into competition now where my little old Nostalgia tractor struggles all every year, you know. It's running in second place right now, but it's a struggle for me to make it do that.
If you're a traditionalist and you've been driving a diesel tractor in the field, you love to see the smoke. If you're a puller or you're a longtime pulling fan, you can watch the smoke itself as it comes from the machine and the starting line. You can listen to the sound of the engine and you know when the boost pressure is right and you know when the fuel is running exactly right. You can tell by the sound and by the side of the machine, not necessarily in its momentum, just how well it's doing. In a Superstock class, the rules talk about the size of engine, the number of turbochargers, but fuel isn't mentioned. There is a controversy in the Superstock class over whether alcohol machines are legal or not. In the very beginning, there was never a problem with the alcohol machines because they were never that competitive. But folks like Leroy Mason and some others have dedicated themselves to see the idea through, and it is working very, very well. And some are wondering if the rules don't need to be changed.
What happened with the diesels and the alcohol back in the mid-70s? First of all, there's always been alcohol. Your little tractors, your 460s, your 88 Olivers, your Minneapolis Molines, they've been running alcohol. And John Deere's to some extent. They've been running alcohol as a fuel source for years. Well, what happened in the mid-70s, 76, 77, a guy named Dave Boom Boom Stengel is what they called it. He had a Minneapolis Moline called Solid Junk, and it was boom boom because it blew up a lot.
And diesel boys was always saying to the alcohol guys, you know, it's too bad you only go about 100 feet, you know, and you pop and fart and quit and all that. And they said, well, you're just gonna have to catch up.
For years, diesel dominated. Alcohol was in its infancy stage.
And finally the Connor brothers come along, you know, Ernie and Brian Connor. Brian, you know, was the brains end of this thing, and Ernie is the mechanical genius.
Brian and I, and we've got another brother, Jeff, he's not too involved in it anymore, but all of us kids and mom and dad, we used to all go pulling in the mid-60s to, oh, till the late 70s and early 80s, we was all, you know, as a family. And when we first started with the alcohol motors, we had an awful time getting the fuel systems straightened out. But we was being picked on because we was different, you know. It was a different fuel. And
1978, I was on the NTPA board, not board, but I was a member from Missouri. And my father and I went out there to represent the state of Missouri at the NTPA board meeting. And I was 18 years old and very impressionable. These guys were my heroes at that time. And they told us point blank, run what you brung and hope you brung enough. And I said, okay. And those are the words that Ernie and I have lived by.
They worked on the alcohol end of the tractor pulling thing, you know. They were always, a lot of people you'll talk to will say Ernie and Brian Connors
are two people who get the rule book and they read it from start to finish, and anything that ain't in that rule book is going to be okay.
It would have been the mid-1980s. Danny Dean, John Klug, and several other of the big diesel guys of that era, they're at a meeting, and Ernie and Brian Connor bring up a point to the guys. They say, hey guys, now what's going to happen if we get this alcohol figured out and we start stomping your ass? And the diesel boys said, well, if you can't stand the heat, get out of the kitchen. Well, the diesel boys are in the frying pan now.
But once the alcohol boys figured out how to make their thing work, they started kicking Fanny, you know. And they're dominating the superstock world, let's face it, you know. But what are we going to do now?
It's been hard for the diesel guys. And you have to understand something about these pullers. Diesel, that's the way they grew up. And, you know, hell's far if you ain't diesel, you ain't going. And they really take it hard when an alcohol boy beats them.
I think we'd have a lot less problems with the diesel guys and the rules and that if Brian and Ernie, they just wouldn't have rubbed it in quite as much back when it first started and all that, and they made a lot of people mad, and a lot of it was the people were laughing at Brian and Ernie and that, so they made them so mad, and then they kind of rubbed it in once they got the tractor going and that. Now, and the diesel guys are all scared to death when Connors calls the office and that and wants them to puts their advice in on a rule and that, and the guys in the office, the diesel guys that are on the board and that, get scared because they figure if the Connors want it, it can't be any good for them.
As far as the diesel and alcohol controversy, there's never in my lifetime, and I don't think in anybody else's lifetime, has anything ever remained the same. There's always a changing of the guard, if you will. What goes around always ends up coming around, makes a full circle.
In 10 years, I think that we'll be the same place we are right now. I think we'll be a dominant player in the sport. I think we'll continue to dominate this sport. I think that there'll be a lot more new technology come out of our two shops. And I think that even though our name is pretty well known out there, I think it'll be more known.
You can't see a lot when you're sitting in the seat, and you can feel a lot. You can feel what the tractor's doing, but you can't really tell how fast you're going because I can't tell the amount of speed that I got until I actually watched it on videotape, and I was like, whoa, that was quick. You know, I've noticed that if you treat it good, she'll treat you good. If you try to beat on her, and she's probably going to end up beating up on you. You got to have respect for these things, because if you lose that respect, or if you lose the edge, and you're going to get hurt.
Yeah, the alcohol is really kind of, you know, I don't like getting real close to them, especially when they're coming down the track, you know, because they're sort of scary. I mean, but, you know, I'm sure the fans love seeing that stuff, you know, watching them stand up on their back wheels and going straight on down the track, you know.
They're down there in the South playing on sandboxes, you know, and it's just like the difference between, I don't know, it's just different, you know, when you're down there, there's no hook. They got all that power, don't do them any good down there either, but there's no bite. But when you bring them up north and put them on these good tracks, gee, man, it's a dangerous tractor.
I don't think the alcohol tractors are any more dangerous than diesel tractors. We don't run near the cylinder pressures. You don't, like I said, you don't see no alcohol tractors splitting a block to camshaft level and tossing her out in the crowd or anything like that. I just don't think that they're near as dangerous. I'm not going to climb on something that's dangerous. If I know in my heart and in my mind that I've got cheap fuel lines on it, do you think I'm going to sit on it and expose myself to a fire? No.
When they start that one-wheel dance down the track, they're in trouble. And if I was a boatman, I'd jerk this thing on them right now. I even want them to do it with me if I'm in that kind of situation. But I'm not going to put it in that kind of a situation. It's not worth it. What is it worth? And I don't want to be a promoter and have to take a boy off of that track dead.
the days of the tractor pulling where they locked up the tires to the track and actually pulled is over with. It's just a race anymore. Whoever gets going the fastest off the line, it ain't. The tires that used to work don't work no more. Things just keep changing.
The alcohol tractors, we mainly run just methanol. Mainly it's the racing alcohol. Like we run the Alky racing fuel. Good fuel, we have no problem with it.
The alcohol is definitely dominating the classes, I see. Very seldom you see a diesel guy, you know, win on a, what you call a 50-50 ratio.
It's hurting a few of the diesel guys. You know, some of the guys that are like me or maybe a little bit, say, less, don't come no more for that very reason. You know, they just not going to travel around when they know the best they're going to finish is second or third.
I don't gripe about alcohol. Only thing is I don't like to see so much domination with brand new technology. You know, I think they need to have rules to where you can keep the sport competitive financially for everybody to run it.
Bottom line is, I've told a lot of people, welcome to the 21st century. I mean, it's time to either get with the program, the crowds are liking what they're seeing. We were at a point in my life, everybody gets a point in their life when you can't compete and you're spending so darn much money on the diesel to keep it running, we had to do something.
I've always ran a diesel. I know quite a bit about alcohol tractors, but I really don't know. I don't know what motivates you to make the choice. I started out with diesel, and I guess that's why that I continue with diesel. I have thought about going to an alcohol tractor, but then I don't want to spend a lot of money. I don't really want all my diesel friends pissed off at me either.
What I would do with alcohol right now, I would probably go and look at how NASCAR restricts motors. You know, they get one guy or one motor out here way ahead of everybody else, they restrict it.
The diesel guys are spending too much money and getting less value than what the alcohol guys are, and they're mad because they're getting beat and they're not doing their own homework. They're just they're going out to buy parts that are just stock parts done over, and they feel they should be able to compete with the same stuff they was running 15 years ago.
The alcohol tractor has it instantly on the line. The minute you hammer it, once the turbos come up to speed, it's got it. I mean, it's got all the torque and all the horsepower it's going to have right there on the line instantly. That's one of the reasons why you get the sled up and moving so fast. Where a diesel tractor, on the other hand, a perfect example is Evansville with Walking Tall. You watch his pass on videotape, the further it goes down the track, the stronger that tractor gets. Because it's making more horsepower, the diesel creates more torque with more heat. And the diesel tractor will have it on the other end, on the finish end, because of the heat aspect. But the alcohol tractor has it on instantly on the line, and then as it goes down the track, as the heat builds up, the horsepower will actually drop off. It'll drop, the curve will go off.
You know, if the guys could, you know, all have big sponsors and be able to buy the best of everything, then I think it should be turned wide open. I mean, I think maybe some limits put on it, but as far as, you know, what kind of horsepower you could make, shouldn't be any limits. But, you know, the pullers doesn't have the big sponsors, and most of it's out of pocket. A lot of them's farmers. It's, you know, sort of limited on income that want to play the game. And, to maybe do some of the things that needs to be done, we are actually going backward, but to keep the tractor numbers in the game that we need, you know, to put on a good show, we may have to go backwards a little bit.
Tell you straight up right now, we will not build backwards. I will not build backwards to go back there, to go back to their level. No, they come up. If you build backwards, I'll tell you what will happen to sport. If you build backwards, what's going to happen is you're going to have a sorrier class. It ain't going to perform like the people have seen it. The problem is Cal's has done out, boys. Gate's been open. The crowd has seen it. The crowd,
the crowd has seen it. Now, next year, if it don't happen and the crowd doesn't see, well, where's it down dirty tractor? Where's it orange peel tractor? Where's it Squealer John Deere that's built? You know, where's Will Heights with that new blue Ford is so pretty? They're going to go, well, they outlawed them. Well, the performance on the class is going to be down. Because instead of seeing somebody go out the gate on the wheelie bars, you know, run 30 mile an hour, they're going to see them snuff them at 150 or 200 feet or crash them. The crowd don't want to see that. And what's going to happen, they're going to, the promoter's going to go, we don't want that class anymore. Get rid of it, add something else. And then the class will die.
But the alcohol is just generating a lot of power, and I think everybody ought to get along as one big family. I mean, I don't see all bickering and everybody mad and upset all the time. I don't like to get that away, and I ain't gonna get that away. When it starts getting to where everybody's gonna be in a bad humor when you show up at a tractor pull, I'll start staying at the house.
Jimmy Mattingly is probably the Mozart of truck pulling. That man has so much natural talent in regards to driving. He's, whatever he gets in, he drives it and he wins. He's got that killer competitive instinct. The guy's a genius in regards to driving ability. There's no doubt about it in my mind.
Jim is, at times, has an industrial strength chip on his shoulder. It's like that he comes out as a competitor and he has to have a revenge motive to be at his very best. And it's like a boxer, he actually has to dislike this guy he's fighting to be his best at boxing. I see that inner drive to succeed and be the best. It goes right back to being the best you can be again. I think that is what makes him possibly sometimes a real fierce competitor.
My dad used to run an auto repair shop, and actually since I was probably 6-7 years old, I've been involved around motorsports, engine repair, auto repair. I guess it was in my early 8, 9, 10 years old, early age, I got into go-kart racing. And we raced go-karts, hell, we built chainsaw motors and raced those for a while. I actually had a drag car when I was 15, couldn't even get it to the racetrack yet, but my first involvement with truck pulling was with some four-wheel modified guys here locally, which was Charles Hamilton and Jimmy Hamilton, related to engine work that I was doing in my shop. They flew me to Houston and to Little Rock and just do maintenance on their stuff. I was interested in it then. That's when two-wheel drives was pretty new, and I was impressed with them then. I've got two super modified blown two-wheel drives, T-bucket bodies, 23 Ford Ts. Well, a T-bucket is like a 1923, they started those in 21 or 2 up to about 27, 1927. Very economical, easy to work on. You don't have body panels in your way. If you do, you can remove it pretty easily. That's really, and the ones we are running are fiberglass, just like all the competitive full body trucks, they're fiberglass. They could have their set up the same way as our T-buckets. They could have them removable. But that's got to be a guy that's got a full-body truck that wants to compete seriously. I've always been one to want to succeed with having something that would outperform somebody else, my own competitive challenge. And I like it. I like doing it. That's why I'm doing what I do today.
Rick Santafort from Cincinnati, Ohio, actually Hamilton, and I'm 52 years old. Yeah, I operate one of the, drive one of the two-wheel drive super modified pulling trucks, and I'm also one of the supporting sponsors. Company's name is Valco Cincinnati Consumer Products Incorporated. I guess through the years we went to fairgrounds and watched a bunch of the events back in the 60s and 70s when they were just farm tractors. And I guess I finally got into a position in my life where I could afford one. And about 13, 14 years ago, we started out doing the fairground pulls with just the smaller vehicles, and one thing led to another, and pretty soon we ended up with in this class. We bought a truck that was called Hard Times, and really, we didn't think that was appropriate, so we changed the name of it. And we came upon the name because everybody asked, why do you do this? And we just tell them, well, we just did it for fun. So that became the name of the truck, was Just for Fun. Well, after you do this for a year or two, you begin to wonder and you get more serious about it. So it became Just for Fun with three dots behind it, kind of like an unfinished statement. And then later on, the three dots got little question marks inside of them. So I still think we're doing it for fun, but obviously this is a semi-pro category, so I mean we all do something else for a living, but all these drivers are real serious about the sport too. You may spend 20 seconds going down the track and a minute or two getting hooked to the sled, and the rest of it is all involved with the pits and traveling and the people and going out to dinner and just having a lot of fun, because this is a semi-pro sport. It's not a professional, and if you don't enjoy that part of it, then you might as well not be in the sport.
I've known Jim for probably 15 years. Jim's a great guy. He's probably one of the most respected pullers in the country by his peers, the actual guys he competes against. He's the big daddy of truck pulling.
The first time I can remember beating Jim, it was, I couldn't believe it, you know, myself, because I'd always watched Jim Lyons, you know, and he was the guy to beat. He was the man. And when I beat him, I felt like I'd made an accomplishment.
My name is Jim Lyons, and I'm from Louisville, Kentucky. I do truck and tractor pulling for a living, and drag race I do for a hobby. Like, I've got two 91 GMCs that I pull, four-wheeler and a two-wheeler. The reason that I've got two like that was, you know, one will pay the expenses. If the other don't do no good, the other one will pay the expenses. Yeah, about the same thing, playing two hands in blackjack. I grew up on a big farm, and the guy next to our farm had a junkyard. And I would go over there and drive his cars through the fields, and I'd take motors out of one and put in the other and drive it around. And if I didn't like that combination, I'd switch to something else. When I first started driving, I drove out on the main road at 11 year old, no driver license, and there were no police around. I've even hauled booze from one county to the other when I was underage.
Jim's a genius. Sometimes he doesn't come off that way, but he is. Jim doesn't want you to know how intelligent he is sometimes. It's part of the old drag racing psychological warfare he would play. The guy, don't ever for any moment think Jim Lyons doesn't know what's going on. Not only does he know what's going on, he knows what your next move is going to be.
I guess the only person cheating is probably Jim Lyons. You know, I accuse him of cheating all the time. I keep telling him, I'm going to catch you one of these days, Jim. I'm going to catch you.
Well, you know, on cheating deal, like everybody says, when you're winning, you're cheating. I don't care who you are, when you're winning, you're cheating. And they haven't caught me.
Have you ever cheated?
No, sir.
In truck pulling in particularly, it's Jim Lyons versus Jim Mattingly, Chevy versus Ford. It's like Kennedy versus Nixon or something, okay? They hate each other.
Are you talking about two bitter rivals that just absolutely don't like each other?
Mattingly's not good for truck and tractor pulling. He's not good for drag racing. He's a crybaby.
Jim Lyons needs to stay out and take care of Jim Lyons' business, and Jimmy Mattingly's gonna do the same.
They don't like each other, okay? I mean, it's mutual understanding, and I'm not hiding anything anybody else is going to see. I think they could be broke down on the side of the road and they'll pass him right on by.
If he breaks down on my way home tonight in front of me, I'm going to blow the horn and pass him by.
Oh, and drag racing is where we first met. Me and Mattingly, we met drag racing. And we drag raced together off and on for, you know, different years.
Me and him was pretty good friends then. I jumped in with him and done a lot of work for him for 3 or 4 years on his stuff. And the first two-wheel drive blown truck I ever drove was Jim Lyons's.
He said he had a friend in Bardstown that he would like to beat at the truck pull. And he said, I want to borrow your truck this weekend to go out there and run. I said, okay, you can borrow it. So he goes out there and he borrows the truck and he actually wins the pull with the truck.
And just told myself, you know, if I ever got into this myself, I'd build a two-wheel drive. And then when I got talking about doing it, Lyons says, you can't do that. You can't afford to compete the way these guys run. I said, y'all can't. Watch me.
Jim Mattingly had a son named Jamie that started competing when I think he was either 14 or 15 in that age range with the Kentucky Truck Pulling Association.
Well, the only thing about the Jamie's revenge deal, I never did understand why he ever come up with it anyway, because we had a rule in KTPA that anyone under 16 that didn't have a driver license could not drive a truck. And he wanted his son to drive, and he was underage and couldn't even drive a car.
Here in the state of Kentucky, there was not an age limit. And when he started running here in Kentucky, he done great.
Jamie also was a very good driver, was very competitive, just like his dad, Jim. He was beating some 20-year veterans.
Lyons, Varners, a whole bunch of them got together, put in a 16-year-old age limit. Took him flat ass out of the seat after he drove for like 6 or 8 months. And that's why he's not here today. He hasn't hooked with me since. And that's why that one truck has that name. It's still his revenge to get even with these guys that took him out of the seat.
Do I think Jim Mattingly and Jim Lyons will ever get along? No way in hell they're ever going to get along. These guys will leave this earth dreaded enemies.
He's a arrogant asshole. He's always blaming something on somebody else. And each time if he don't win, it's somebody's fault. And I just don't want nothing to do with a guy like that.
Lyons has been known to do some cheating. But if he wants to do honest competition, I'll pull with him every day. Or race with him every day. But from what he's done to my family and caused my son to quit pulling, my goal if I pull in, he's here, is to beat him.
In the two-wheel drive truck class, there's a lot of competition, and there are some machines that don't look anything like trucks. And there is a great deal of controversy going on now between the pullers in that particular class about what's legal and what's not, namely a full-size truck body or a T-bucket.
Somebody's going to go out in the parking lot and get in a three-quarter ton Chevy or a three-quarter ton Ford and drive it home after these events, and they can actually see that in our vehicle because we've got mirrors, bumpers, and the whole deal. Not too many people are going to go jump in a T-bucket and drive home.
I think they need to look like a truck. I've had a lot of people walk up to me and ask me, you know, what is that thing over there? You know, it's those little T-bucks, they all look alike.
You know, everybody looks at when you have a truck pull as a truck. Not no T-bucket, because a T-bucket don't relate to nothing but a tractor.
The T-buckets, they're not a truck. And people do not understand, you know, they think they're a miniature unlimited. I mean, we've heard them called that before, because people cannot relate to them.
Through this whole entire season, I haven't had any fan come up and say, well, what is this thing? You know, so I think the fans like them. They're different, they're exotic, they can see the driver. This is, of course, my opinion, and somebody with another puller watching this would think it's self-centered, and I don't mean it that way at all.
There's no doubt that the T-bucket, roadster, whatever, has a weight advantage, a movable weight advantage.
The thought is that the T-bucket body, actually being a lot lighter, a lot smaller, can be placed on the chassis wherever the driver wants to give a lot better weight distribution.
The ideal situation on a truck would be is if you have it built like a bridge, where you have two end posts, and you take your truck body and you put it on it, and you want to concentrate, if this is the rear of the truck, you want as much weight there and as much weight on the front of the truck as possible. All the weight in between the truck in between these two points is of minimal value because of the way the truck is designed. What happens with a full body truck is you have this full body here that weighs a lot, and it distributes a lot of weight from one end of the truck to the other evenly. What you do with a T-bucket is you have a very little frame that comes in here and sets in, and you have all the weight on one end or the other. And what we're talking about is a big lever here.
Let's say we got more weight, you know, more weight advantage, more movable weight. It's a little bit more visible. You can see out of them a little better, you know, the sideline, stuff like this. But really, what I've watched it all year and I pulled for so many years, right now, it's really not the T-bucket advantage. It's just the guys with the T-bucket are using their heads, and we've kept records for over the last 8 years of every place we've pulled, so we know what the dirt was like, the sleds were like. And we've got a little advantage that way, and I think that's the guys that are doing all the complaining about wanting to split the trucks up. Our guys are not watching the tracks, they're not moving their weights, they're not changing air pressure in their tires. And that's the reason they're where they are. It's not that they're not, the trucks and the T-buckets aren't competitive. They're competitive together, it's just they aren't doing it.
There's no part of that T-bucket body that pulls that sled. All these two-wheel drive trucks, everybody's either using a Engler frame, they're using a Banner frame, they're using a Humpco frame. We've all got the same thing. We're all at the same rules. And what body's on that vehicle does not make it a better pulling vehicle, because no part of that body pulls the sled.
Right now, you know, the top four trucks are T-buckets. They're trying to, there's just some of them want trucks in there instead of the T-buckets.
This year, that's an issue. Last year, it wasn't. We didn't compete that much with this organization last year, and that wasn't an issue last year. This year, it's a hell of an issue.
Honors has won it in a body truck, and I've won it in a body truck. And McPherson's won it in a T-bucket. Mattingly's won it in a T-bucket. But the last couple of years, it's been the T-bucket's just dominating the deal.
I mean, I really think that they did have the advantage, and it was getting out of hand. Every time you turned around, every weekend, there was a new T-bucket, and it was not going to be truck pulling. After a while, it was going to be T-bucket pulling.
Is that the best thing for the sport? For promoting sponsorship, people don't drive T-buckets. They drive full-bodied trucks. I think for my own personal feeling is, obviously, my trucks are full-bodied trucks. We recognize that we're giving up some competitive advantage with that. It would be nice to convince the sanctioning body to put some rules and regulations on that make them competitive.
I think they're making excuses for their own performance. The guys that's run T-buckets with us this year are running hard. They're running to win. Don't care if they break parts. And some of the guys that's running the full body trucks are running to run their motor all year, run conservative. We go to win. A lot of times we don't, but we go to win.
Leroy's he's a nice guy. He actually kind of complains a little too much for a guy that's winning as many pulls as he has. I mean, he's dominated this year.
I think it's Leroy's been against the world. Now, what's happened in that class is Leroy Mason has been the class act.
Well, Leroy was good last year. He's gotten better this year. And we give him 200 more pounds this year. Last year was all 55. It was more of a shuffle, you know, in the winnings of the year. But now you give him 200 more pounds and it's over.
Well, I think Diesels just need to step up and quit their crying.
That's it.
Huh?
Stop whining and start wrenching. Right, Jeff?
Build some parts and they can compete. I mean, they need to go back to school and read all the laws of physics and that and all that. figure out that diesel should make more horsepower if they build the right parts. I mean, there's more BTUs than diesel fuel and alcohol. Yep.
My fear is Leroy is just the first of the one guy up there. I mean, I got a feeling that the way people want to spend money at this tractor pulling now, that they're going to want to spend money doing what Leroy's doing and doing it even better.
Okay, and I hate to see us pull our rules back in time. And let's face it, we're pulling them back 5 years in time.
The meeting was about, you know, alcohol versus diesel. There is a problem with alcohol, diesel.
It was basically they're wanting to try to set up some rules for next year, and looked like to me it was about me. It looks like you're wanting to try to pull the technology back and set us back 10 to 15 years.
Yeah, okay, the president, whatever.
I know of at least three or four pulls where the second place man was at least 65 to 70 foot behind the first place man. You tell me something ain't out of bounds. You know, the second place has not been dominated by anybody all year. I mean, it's been passed around amongst several pullers. First place has been, you know, kind of tied up by one tractor.
Because we're not here to put anybody out. Well, no, we're not really trying to put anybody out. We're just trying to equal the class.
I don't know that the tension ever will get calmed down between alcohol and diesels. To me, I don't give a shit.
I mean, if you want to make an alcohol class and a diesel class, I think it'd be
there
the greatest thing
there we go, create another class,
was.
Mike. I
know, but I still think it'd be the greatest thing it ever was.
I think they, you know, they want to try to pull us backwards. And instead of them coming forward.
I'm not in favor of splitting the class from alcohol and diesel. I'm not in favor of doing it to the 5 or the 7 because we've got enough classes in America and we can't be creating more classes.
It depends on what they're going to do. If they're going to leave this class at 5,700, you're going to take a lot of tractors home. That's what you're going to do. And there may be some, 4 or 5 built, but there's going to be a lot, about a dozen go home. That's what I see.
What about overhead cam in diesels?
I don't think it'll be allowed either. Did he come from factory that way?
Well, no, but what I'm saying is there's no rule against them right now.
Well, just eliminate overhead cams altogether.
How are they doing that? They're wanting to say, well, we want to pull the aluminum heads off and make us all run cast heads, and you know, drop the turbochargers back to 2 turbos and drop on alcohol and then 3 on diesel.
If you're still going to allow us to run aluminum, then leave it like it is. If you're going to restrict us back to the OEM, which I'm really not in favor of to start with, that's where I'm at now, then no, I wouldn't want no overhead cams on those.
How many of you guys aluminum heads are willing to put OEM heads on?
So somebody who's winning, you know, everybody's going to shoot for that guy. And if that guy's really got his act together, in which it's in any motorsport, it'd be being tractor pulling, drag racing, round-to-round car, everybody's going to try to find something wrong and try to, and they're going to want to correct that. Or let's punish him, or let's factor him. Let's take that away from him, or take that away from him. But when they do that, it just makes that guy want to figure it out that much more.
You know, I'm just trying to get the class. There's a lot of tractors went home. Now, I'm not, like I said, not trying to put nobody out. I know Leroy feels like we are. But if you had 12 tractors that ran like Leroy's, then the rest of us ought to be running somewhere else, and you'd have a good show. But you don't have enough people, I don't think, that can spend, you know, $100,000 getting up into this fast alcohol ride, you know, that's going on.
I think the crowd likes the Super Stock too because they get a combination of diesel and alcohol, okay?
But you're only going to have about 4 tractors that, the way I'm seeing it right now, that are probably going to be run that light class that can run on Leroy's caliber. You know, some changes needs to be made. And maybe some of the changes that you know, we've talked about today could be taking us back some in time. But again, you come back to the money thing of, you know, the guys that can afford, you know, just what the guys can afford. And, you know, a 4-tractor class will not last. And, you know, a 4 or 5-tractor class will not last. And you know, there's just not enough guys with big sponsors and a lot of money flow to compete. And if, you know, it would be great if it was. It would be great if the guy, you know, if we had 15 guys, you know, with good sponsors, and could make these tractors go and as fast as they could go and put on the show that, you know, a lot of the crowd comes to watch. But since this is not, you know, happening, then we may have to back it up a little bit so that the tractors that are available, you know, will stay on a competitive basis.
This is crunch time now because in June and July, everybody's still friends because we still got time to catch him. After tonight, there's only one more event. So there's only one more. There's what, like tonight in Georgetown, Ohio, that's it. No more. Now it's getting to the point like last weekend at Litchfield that the only people that would park around this is the truck rollers.
Okay, guys, appreciate it. Thank you for the meeting, and I'll give him a call the word on everything and see what he thinks. And we're going to try to get you an answer, but 15th October on the rules.
Some of the guys have always said that it's, oh boy, that's tough. It's tough to, there's an old cliche, it's lonely at the top.
Well, on T-Buckets, if Mom had allowed us to in 1985, the first vehicle we built would have been a T-Bucket. That was our original intentions, but she wouldn't have any part of it. She says, if you build a T-Bucket, I'm not going. It's a truck pulling, I'll go watch. And so that's why we didn't. But we'd have had one a long time ago.
TJ was the first, of course he was older, and he seemed interested in it. He loved the mechanics of it and all that. And so he started coming in the garage, and that actually helped me ever since he was about 8 years old. And I made him a promise that if when he was 16, if he kept his grades up, stayed out of trouble, stayed in school and everything, that I would, and when 16 was the minimum age, he could drive the truck anyway, I told him that it was his. When he turned 16, he started driving and has driven ever since.
We ran full bodies ever since we started pulling. A couple of years ago, me and my father first started talking about going from a full body to a T-bucket. We heard from other pullers that they didn't have any advantages, and some said they did. So we thought to ourselves, we'll build one and see. We found between the two trucks, the one being the full body and one being the Roadster, that two of the assumptions we had made earlier were true. One is it had more movable weight, because it had a whole lot lighter body, probably 300 or 400 pounds more movable weight versus our full body truck. And two, the visibility.
This is where the T-bucket situation come in. Three items scared us a little bit and got us really to where we felt we had to do something. One was Tony Tatum brought out a Roadster this year that was very much like a rail.
We brought it out this past summer and we campaigned the full body in the T-bucket, the Roadster. It seemed like after we got ours built, then there was a lot of controversy come up that, you know, well, should we stick with full body trucks or Roadsters?
If you ask Tony now, I think he'll tell you that his entire purpose was to prove a point.
We built the Roadster kind of as a prod to get him to do something. And that's one reason we put as little a body as we could on it. We thought about taking a 5 gallon bucket and putting it on there and saying that, you know, this is a bucket. If they don't do something, then this will probably be the last year you'll see Foolish Pleasure with a full body. It will have a Roadster or some type little body on it, because if you can't beat them, you got to join them or you got to quit.
We've seen the pullers that had full body trucks, marketable trucks that we can sell to sponsors, had been beat by the T-buckets because of the wheelbase thing. So they were going to put T-buckets on their frames. So all of a sudden we're sitting here with a situation of 2 years, we've got a class of all T-buckets, C-cabs, this type, rails, that we can't market, we can't take to the future. They're going to become a regional class and have to be left behind. And it's a very, very popular class. I love the class. Or we have to make a drastic move and try to stop it now.
In professional pulling, the problem I've got with it, if we're going to advance this sport to the next level, and the ATPA is, we have got to be on the cutting edge. Drag racing and NASCAR wouldn't be where they are today if your 1998 world champion in either class or sanctioning body or what have you was running a 1923 Ford. People would look at it and go, what the hell's going on? Because people come to these events to see the latest, the greatest, the best and the fastest. And this year in the two-wheel drive truck category, the top four were using sheet metal from the 1920s. I have a problem with that.
When did you realize the T-buckets might be banned?
I think that actually started immediately, but it didn't come to the surface where we could actually hear it. It was probably about, we weren't 50%, we wasn't at the halfway point through the season when they commenced complaining about, well, this T-bucket this and this T-bucket that and wheelbase this and wheelbase that. I went to Tom McConnell, the president of ATPA, and I asked him, I said, what is the problem? I said, you've asked me to come run with you. You just about begged me to come run with you. I said, I've done that, and now I'm hearing complaints. And he said, well, he said, they're griping about your tee buckets. He said, but I sit in the stands last night and listened to the crowd, and he said, man, they loved them. He said, keep smiling because nothing's going to happen.
If we're going to move this to the next level, those vehicles are going to have to put bodies on, period.
They want to outlaw our tee buckets. They want us to have to change our tee buckets, either put bodies on them or put wheelbases on them.
They hit us up the deal tonight, maybe putting one if we wouldn't put truck bodies on these, and you know, for next year. And it isn't going to happen.
We're not going to do shit. They're not going to piss us off. They're not going to make us mad. We're going to go out here and pull. They're going to have them guys with that's doing the complaining. They're going to have to run their shit just hard as we do, or they can't run with us. Pretty simple.
Right now they're wanting to kind of bump the top four trucks with T-buckets, and now they're wanting to knock us out of the whole deal. So I don't know what's going to happen over this.
Dick McPherson and myself had that conversation, and he told the guys that were complaining about the T-buckets that same thing. He said, boys, he said, T-buckets have not been an issue. I've had my two since we've been running this thing for 3 years. Why is it an issue now? And my name was brought into that, and Dick says, all you got to do is beat him. He said, you can check him if you think he's wrong. Just get your ass out there and beat him in the dirt. Don't beat him back here in the pits.
Nobody wants to change their equipment. If they're happy with what they've got, you know, it's kind of a pain in the butt to start redoing your whole program. I guess I was aware that Jim was unhappy with the situation. I felt we had gotten along fine all year. Jim's a good puller. He's got good equipment. I think whether he runs a T-bucket or a full-body truck, he's going to be someone to contend with. It's hard to say, does he like the T-bucket that much that he's going to fight for it? Or does he not think that he can make a full-body truck run well? I believe he does.
I hate to really point the finger directly, but I think at this point, everybody in the country knows. There's really a small group with one leader. I think I can safely say that pretty much everybody in the two-wheel drive class knows that Rich Sanford despises T-buckets. He hasn't won a pull in 1998. Jim Lyons was supporting him 100% because Jim couldn't run with us anymore. He hasn't updated his equipment.
It's not me that caused the problem. It's all the guys that's got the trucks. They know, you know, here's 3 years straight in a row that the T-buckets has won the point circuit, and there's no way that we can compete with them.
Well, because I am a sponsor and a puller, I try to walk a line where I don't cross over it one way or the other. I don't think it's necessarily fair for a sponsor to come in and dictate to a sanctioning body how they should run their event. But by the same token, I don't think it would be unusual to offer suggestions. And if you have an idea, you ought to bring it forward if you think it's going to help the organization. The other way, as a puller, I'm free to have the same thoughts any other puller does.
The only people that's going to suffer out of this rule change with ATPA is going to be the fans. People sitting in the stands are used to seeing the McPhersons, the Mattinglys, the Nations, whoever it might be, serious competitors. And a lot of those serious competitors aren't going to be. I don't mean all of them are not serious competitors, but 50% of your major serious competitors are not going to participate at ATPA events this year.
Thank you.
in our lightweight supers for next year on the rules. We don't want to put engine limitations on. And we're talking about the future again here. If we pull, if we done away with aluminum heads, if we done away with overhead cams, if we done away with a turbocharger on alcohol, what we've basically done is put the class back 10 years engine-wise. And then in 3 years, the promoter's not going to book the class only on a regional level. We want to take the class up the ladder with us, okay? So we're trying to look for their best benefit.
Because something the alcohol guys have to realize, though, the diesel guy, they don't have the diesel guys there. If only 5 or 6 of them show up, the promoter's just going to book a pro stock class and the super stock class is lost. So they better accept the fact they're outcast to a certain extent now. There's going to be more coming along. And there's outcast diesel guys like Danny Bill and the Connor brothers working. Somewhere along the line, somebody's going to do something different with the diesel. It's going to pay off. And what we've got to do at that point, what we've got to do till that point comes, till they can run heads up, we've got to guarantee our promoters a show, we've got to guarantee our spectators a show, and we've got to keep guys coming to the event. So we're going to, instead of slowing down technology, putting in restrictor plates, limiting overhead cams, we do not want the vehicles to slow down. We do not want the technology to slow down. We want the technology, we want to make these guys go faster. What we're going to do in the super stock class is to give the diesels some extra weight, and what are we going to do with it? I don't know what it's going to do. We're just going to play with it.
They decided to give the diesel tractors a couple hundred pound to try to hope and to so-called even it up. Maybe hoping maybe with 200 pound they would balance better, or you know, give them some kind of weight advantage. I don't like handicapping. Never have believed in it. I'm a heads up type. Let's do it. The technology, I've preached this all year, and I've preached this for forever. Build some parts.
Okay, let's talk about rules for a minute. That makes us unpopular with a lot of people. It makes us popular with a lot of people. The problem classes that you have as a sanctioning body is where you either have two different fuel types within a class or whether you have two different chassis types. This is where the T-bucket situation come in. Yes, there is a pulling advantage to T-buckets over full-bodied trucks because of the movable weight and because of the long wheelbase. They don't deny that. They will until they see that we're wanting to change the rules, and then they admit to it. The problem is in marketing. We really never listen to any pullers about it.
It's a tough decision. Obviously, there's a lot of loyalty with the T-bucket guys, but I think what they'll do is they'll go out and talk to all the drivers and get their opinion on it and see where they stand. Any sanctioning body has to be somewhat dictatorial in the way they run. You can't run as a democracy because you'll never get any decisions made.
And what we are planning on doing, it'll be effective probably end of this week, is we're not going to outlaw T-buckets the first year out. We're going to let them run with us, compete for the class purse, but our points fund money and our TV is primarily going to be focused on full-bodied trucks. We're trying to send a message to them saying, guys, we don't do this lightly. They think we'd make these decisions very lightly, and that's totally wrong.
I wasn't happy when it all came around, but you know, it's a rule, so it's like everything else. We just have to live with it and go on, and so we're just gonna go with it and see what happens. And
I don't feel it's a big difference. It's gonna be a change for us and something we're gonna have to work with. We figure that probably by the time we're done, we're gonna have $10,000 in the vehicle itself, as well as it being larger than what the T-bucket was overall. As far as the body size, that means that it doesn't fit in the van trailer as well, so we have to have a larger trailer. That's probably another $25,000 to $30,000, so it's gonna be quite an investment.
This 1998 season has been a turmoil year for the two-wheel drive class and the super stock tractors. Excuse me. And yeah, I'm not giving up the sport, but right now I'm gonna let this transition of the class being broken run its course. I'm not going to do the work or spend the money again on my trucks that I spent last winter to update them, to make them nice.
to be very competitive. I'm not going to make that transition yet till I see what the rules stabilize and see what they come to.
Whatever the mind can conceive of, it can create. And that's a very simple yet very powerful statement. I want to put it back in your minds again. Whatever the mind can conceive of, it can create. That is basically means that if we as individuals empower ourselves and believe in whatever it is we are doing, we will not only achieve our goals, but we will create on new reality. And that is what the ATPA is about, creating a new reality for our beloved sport of truck and tractor pulling. The ATPA will be the first sanctioning body in the history of the sport to be a true national organization. We'll be the first organization in the history to have pulling under one umbrella from the Pacific to the Atlantic. What this does is it creates a new reality and it helps to unite the sport. NASCAR and drag racing would not be anything today if they would have simply remained fragmented. The first new reality that the ATPA is going to create is acceptance as a true motorsport by our colleagues in other motorsports. You may think we're accepted by the drag racers and the NASCAR people. We're not yet. Go to the PRI show, they still look at us as a bunch of hillbillies. We're going to change that. You're going to change that. The other thing we're going to do to help create this new reality is presenting ourselves as professionals. And that will be achieved by doing what we do and taking it seriously. Drag racing and NASCAR wouldn't be where they are today had they allowed monster trucks and other mechanized freak shows at the halftime of their events. You go to a national drag race, you go to a NASCAR event, all you see is that, and that stands alone. Pulling must remain that way as well. But this is not the goal of the ATPA. This will simply occur because our goal to create a new reality is to make pulling a respected sport. I want to say that again. The goal of the ATPA is to make the sport of pulling a respected sport. There's going to come a time when you're going to open the New York Times, USA Today, and you're going to look at the results of the NFL, the NBA, and the ATPA. They laughed at NASCAR, buddy. They're not laughing now. There's also going to come a time when, at this time of the year, many people in this room 10 to 15 years from now are going to find it rather difficult to Christmas shop because of the hordes of fans that are going to be around you. How we are going to achieve this goal, three ways we're going to do it. The first thing is to unite the sport. The second is the national promotion of the sport through the televisions, through the newspapers, through the movie. The third is the most difficult one for everybody in this room, myself included. Perseverance and patience. It's going to take some time, but when we get there, it will be well, well worth it. Whatever the mind can conceive, it tends to create. The new reality of pulling is the ATPA, and the goal of the ATPA is to make pulling a truly respected sport.
We pulled hard this year with ATPA. I couldn't make the first event, but we made all the rest of them, and all the competitors turn out to be your best friends, and that's what I like about tractor pulling.
I'm not very good at these speeches. Last year I felt it's happening already. shit. Anyways, there we go. I just appreciate all the sponsors, everybody back home, good Lord above. Just thanks to everybody.
Well, I'd just like to thank Jasper and ATPA and my family, my wife, especially my wife. She kind of gets tore up about this stuff. And Tom, I really like to thank Tom McConnell. Here about 7 or 8 years ago, I saw this little goofy guy walking around Lebanon, Kentucky. I swear to God, I thought, you know, who is this clown? And he said, I'm gonna start a new big organization here. And he said, I'm gonna take over this thing. And I thought, yeah. Now look at it. So I like to appreciate it. Thank
you. And the winner in the lightweight superstock class, picking up $8,000, presents to you the 1998 Jasper Engines and Transmissions lightweight champion, Mr. Leroy Mason, with the Down and Dirty.
I think Leroy Mason is one hell of a guy. He's a good friend, a very serious competitor, guy you're not gonna keep down. You can make a rule change, I think he'll be back. I hope Leroy does good this year. I'll give him a thumbs up. Hope he kicks their ass again.
Okay, don't shoot. We just got lucky here. We just kept hooking, kept running it. You know, that's the main thing. We got real lucky again, and just got the. She hung in there for us. Got made go down the track every time. You heard me thank everybody before. That's about the only group I can thank, except for Joe and Carol and Gina. They put me on the front of the magazine. I really appreciated that. Anyway, everything worked out. And just thank y'all.
We won that points title this year, and I was the lightweight super is. We love that class. We absolutely, that's the class we've always ran. And I just kind of following in Dad's footsteps there. I love that class. This sport gets in your blood. And I think it's a combination of things. It's a combination of things. It's the rush. The roar of the crowd, the sheer feeling of that power, and to win.
All right, now we would like to present to you the 1998 Jasper Engines and Transmissions Super Modified World Champion, and he also finished third in the class as well, picking up $8,000 from Bardstown, Kentucky, Mr. Jimmy Mattingly, the high roller.
I like Jimmy. Jimmy, I feel Jimmy's a friend. And he, hell of a driver. He knows that vehicle. He knows his motors. He knows his machine work. He knows what it's capable of doing. He'll put it to the track. He'll make it work. My feeling is that the body don't make the truck go any further. The body's just there for cosmetic reasons. It's there for looks. I think you could just put a carbon fiber body on Jimmy Mattingly's trucks and it'd do the same thing.
I'm not very good at speeches. I've got a little bit I'd like to say. I'd like to thank Jasper for being a full supporter for us this year. John Fuchs, big help. Tom McConnell for putting this deal together for us to be able to run. I guess I'll have to thank Mr. Sandiford for giving me a vacation this next year. I don't think I'm going to be able to run my vehicles with this organization next year, as bad as I hate to say that. But I'd like to thank everyone else involved. We've had a great year. I'd like to thank my family for helping me. It's been great. Thank you.
On a national level, this is the best year I've ever had. When we used to run Grand National and TPA, we won. We done good there too, but I focused harder this year. I put a lot of effort into running points this year, but I'd say this has been my best year. No, you don't ever really compete against the other guys. You know what you got to do yourself, and it's the person that makes the best run himself and his setup's the best and his stuff runs the best is going to be the guy out front.
Sometimes the luck of the draw will hamper that. That can make a difference on that. But most generally, the guy that does the most homework, the guy that's got the best parts, and the guy that doesn't care to push his equipment to the limit is going to be the guy out front.
So how many tractor pulls have you been to?
47.
47 tractor pulls?
Yeah.
What do you like about tractor pulls?
I don't know. It's just in the gremlin. I mean, just the power, the sight of the people. I mean, that's what it is with me. I mean, it's, I like something like that.
So what's your favorite part, the trucks or the tractors?
The drinking. Probably the drinking.
Woo! Could you tell me how many beers you consume at a tractor pull?
Three. Three.
Yeah. No,
pace and time three.
Yeah. Three. You like fishing. When you go fishing, that old man get your hook, carry your old piece. You know what I mean? Make
I started way back when it was at Thorn Grove. That was just a little dirt pile. And ever since then, it's like, you know, cocaine. I've been addicted to them.
Is that one plugged in? There's a microphone?
I love it all out. I love it. I love the power that the trucks are pulling, the tractors are pulling. I just love it all.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. So when a Chevrolet comes through, we're like, go Chevrolet.
And when Ford comes through, we're like, go Ford.
It's like you split your friends. I mean, either you're Earnhardt or you're like, you know, you got to pay for it. I mean, Mark, it's Mark. Like, you see?
He sunk some money into it. And he sunk a mega buck in it. He sunk a master mega buck in his tractor.
Yes! I'd love to drive one of these babies. Any day, any time. I would love it. Yes!
No. Did I drive anything?
What's your favorite part of it besides the Chevrolets? I just want the power! What do you think makes a guy spend $100,000 and come out here and try the power? There's got to be the power! Yes! Yeah!